Alright. Anyway, I'm skimming through this like hyper speed, so anyway, this 1 John chapter 5, 2 John chapter 5, New Testament. You know, here we are, where the question is, why not the words of red? Why aren't they scattered throughout the whole New Testament? Apostle Paul doesn't use the words in red. He don't use Yeshua's parables at all, because he knows they're only applicable to the Old Testament. They ain't for the New Testament. They ain't for the Christian life. And John backs this up with his letters too. When we have the right perspective, when we know how to read, and we know what they're what he's writing about, it all makes perfect sense. In that sense, there is perfection, because it all makes perfect sense. And John even backs that up. He uses the word perfection now, because once we know the truth, it's all perfect now. It's all good, because we know we ain't got to be perfect. So now we're in perfect harmony with what truth is. We know that the law of Moses doesn't apply to us. And we know about what the sin is. We know the truth perfectly. And Paul talks about this too when he's talked about prophecy. You know, prophecies are going to cease. They have ceased ever since the apostles died out. Signs and wonders, all that stuff, it ceased. Because what is perfect has come. A perfect knowledge of what the truth is. That's all behind us. There ain't no prophecies no more today. There ain't no prophets. Everybody that's going around prophesying and calling themselves prophets are off their rockers, because they don't know what the truth is. And they're in danger of the eternal death. But those of us that know the truth are praying and asking, and we shall receive, if they were from the very foundation of the earth chosen to enter into eternal life. Some people were chosen to enter into eternal death. So we're not to pray for them to come back into eternal life, because Yahweh's already, the Most High, has already made up his mind when he came up with his plan way back when. He created some to go to death and some to go to life. And it makes sense, because you have to have some creation go to death so that he can show his power, that he's fair and all-powerful, and no one can be like him. So you have those over here that tried being like him, so they have to go to death. It has to be that way, so there's a historical record in all of eternity that we know that he is the Most All-Superior High, and there's no one like him, and no one can be like him. So some have to go to death. So we don't pray for them to come back into life. They're made to go to death. So that we can have life. So we ain't praying for them to come back from to come out of their the sin. So anyway, we keep going on. For we know that whoever is born of the Most High sinneth not. And there it is again. I'm going to touch on it again. He's not talking about sin as in lying, stealing, killing, destroying, and all that. He's talking about the sin. Those that know the truth aren't participating in the sin no more. They come out of the world. They come out of that junk, that old way of thinking. They've come out of the words of red. The parables of Yeshua, they don't apply them to their life. They ain't trying to be one of the few that got in through the narrow door. They ain't trying to build their house on the rock. They ain't trying to set their candles on a lampstand for all the world to see. And all the other parables we're going to go through Matthew, however long it's going to take. I and other men like me, and you know, and there's some women who know how to teach it too, you know, are gonna show us how to know what truth is. So anyway, I just want to skim through that real quick, but let's get right to the very end. Okay, this is 2 John chapter 5. we know that whoever is born of the Most High sinneth not, but he that is begotten of the Most High keepeth himself, and the wicked one toucheth him not. And we know that we are of the Most High, and the world lieth in wickedness. And we know that the Son of the Most High is coming, and hath given us understanding, that we may know him that is true, and we are in him that is true, even the Son, Yeshua Christ. This is the true Most High and eternal life. Little children, keep yourselves from idols. Amen. When he's talking about idols, he's talking about the idols of the sin. Everything that has to do with it. Everything.
Hey, you can start getting back to Matthew chapter 5, the mid-teens.
The mid-20s. So let's go back, now that we've laid that little foundation for today, now we're going to expound on that. Let's go back to Matthew chapter 5, and let's read the 20s. Matthew chapter 5 and the 20s again. So that we can...
Boy, you sure are a stinking little thing. You are a stinking little thing. Stinking. Stinkling.
You're a funny little stunk. Funny little stunk. So let's just do a little review too for Matthew 5. How's it start off? How's Matthew 5 start off? Starts off the Sermon on the Mount. Starts off with the Beatitudes right from the get-go. And the Beatitudes are describing perfection. And we know that the Beatitudes are describing perfection because we can see it more clearly in Luke's occasion of it. He expounds on a more clear picture. And we went over that in the video series. All we have to do is go back and read it, listen to him again, all that other good stuff. Luke chapter 6. So he talks about the Beatitudes, and he goes into being salt and light. He's being sarcastic. Nobody can be salt or light, and everybody has lost their savor. And he goes in, he starts talking about lights, putting lights on candlesticks and lights on hills for everybody to see. But who can do this? Nobody, because Yeshua is, again, being sarcastic. One thing is said, another is intended. And then he goes on and he talks about, he says, I've come to fulfill the law. I've come to do it. Only me. Me. That's the tone of his voice here when he says this. I have come to fulfill the law. Don't think I've come to destroy the law. See, he's talking about the law, man. When he's talking about the Beatitudes, he's right on subject throughout the whole thing. He's talking about the law, and the Beatitudes are part of the law. They ain't some Rosemary, Hail Mary, uplifting, you know, words to apply to our life. Oh, blessed are the meek. Make us meek, O Lord, so make us poor and help the poor. Blessed us our sin spirit, because we'll have eternal life. And the kingdom of heaven will be ours. And we're, help us to be meek. And the Lord's Prayer and all that. No. Yeshua is dealing strictly 100% with the law of Moses, because the Israelites have made a bogus verbal contract. They told Moses all that the Lord, the Most High, says we will do. When Moses came out of the mountain with the Ten Commandments, the Israelites fell right into the trick of the devil again. Right into the trick. The same old trick. Trying to be like the Most High, fell right into it. Head over heels, they just right over the cliff. Didn't even look. They just went right to the edge of the cliff and just jumped without even thinking about it. All of them, like a herd of cows, man. Like a herd of cows. So